is Anna Navarro. Kelly, does it worry you that if Donald Trump brings up Bill Clinton's marital infidelities and sex scandals, that then Donald Trump's past is brought up as well?
Yes, because I think then it turns into a battle over marriages and past from the 90s, and I don't think that serves either candidate to bring new voters on board. That being said, I think it's effective for people like Kellyanne Conway to go on The View and bring up some of Hillary Clinton's past and allegedly bullying some of these women. So I think the surrogates doing it is one thing, but I don't think the candidate should do it.
Christine, is it fair game?
I mean, I just think it's an inappropriate conversation for either side. I wouldn't want Donald Trump to do it. I wouldn't want the Clinton campaign to do it either. These are things about people's past marriages. And honestly, Donald Trump is in no position to be throwing stones at other people. And why don't we try, finally, in the final days, to keep this election about the issues, about the candidates, and not have, and to say it's not appropriate for Mr. Trump to say it, but it is okay for the surrogates to say it, is such a strategic splitting of hairs. It goes against the idea of trying to have some level of decorum and dignity in a race for the most important office in the world. And let's not talk about their marriages and the issues that happened. Let's talk about the issues that the Trump campaign says over and over it wants to talk about.
Should the Trump surrogates then be fair game to be questioned about Trump's marital history?
Well, I don't think this is about, I agree, let's not talk about marriages, but my issue is when Hillary Clinton sends out a tweet, has a section on her website saying sexual assault victims deserve to be heard and believed, but yet the New York Times reports that she's called some of these women floozy, bimbo, stalker. You know, these are not appropriate words to be calling people who have these very serious allegations. So when she opens that issue, then we have to look at how she's treated that issue in her personal life.
I think it's very clear that Hillary Clinton's history, her life's history, about working, and we've had this conversation before where you and the Trump campaign throw these attacks at Secretary Clinton. Probably no one in the world has done more to help survivors of rape and sexual assault and female genital mutilization and sex trafficking than Hillary Clinton. Let's not go
except
there.
Except in the 1992 war room when she's putting private investigators on any woman who...
It's all what the Trump campaign does, quite honestly. They say, as you mentioned before, Anderson, I'm not going to do that. But then they find this back door around the way to do it and think they're kind of tricking Americans, not dignified.
There are a lot of folks, even Republican strategists, who worry that bringing this up could backfire on Trump, that it would basically play into Clinton's case that he's a bully, that he degrades, humiliates women. If he went there, how do you think it would play out?
I think we are seeing how it's playing out, and I think it's playing out incredibly negatively for him. He already has a practically 20-point gap with women, one of the largest in history, and he continues digging that hole for himself. Let's just take a look at what's happened in the last 7 days. First, they announced that they're inviting Jennifer Flowers, one of Bill Clinton's former girlfriend's mistresses, to the debate to sit on the front row. Then during the debate, he goes after Rosie O'Donnell again. What are you doing? You are a presidential candidate. You are the Republican nominee. Why are you punching down? Go punch at Putin. Go punch at Kim Jong-un. What are you doing going after Rosie O'Donnell? What are you doing trashing Alicia Machado, the former Miss Universe? So I think the way he has reacted to the charges of sexism have reminded us, after he has stayed 3 or 4 weeks to script to the teleprompter and had not been horrifically offensive, he has now reminded us in the last five days why he is so unfit to be president, because he does not have the character needed to be presidential.
Maggie, I mean, to the point that Anna raised about trying to appeal to women voters, which is important for Donald Trump, I mean, he does have a real deficit compared to Hillary Clinton on appeal to women voters.
Right. I mean, this is why the Machado comments resonated. This is why the fact that Trump kept talking about them, Newt Gingrich kept talking about them, one of his top advisors, was problematic for him. He has struggled throughout this campaign to move towards something that would be a productive form of outreach on this and other areas, including to black voters, including to Hispanic voters. This is going to end up being, I think, another week wasted when really the conversation is, yes, it's being injected into the bloodstream because there's the will he do this when he gets to the stage, but at the end of the day, voters are indeed hearing this about the Clintons, but you're also hearing from Republicans saying, a lot of them saying, we don't want to talk about the past, we should just move forward. And elections are always about the future. So I just think it's, for Trump's case, it's going to be very hard to get elected if he doesn't change that number of the gender gap, and I don't know that this was a week that went toward doing it.
He seems committed to not changing the gender gap. I mean, what he did at the debate, how he doubled down on the former Miss Universe the day after on Fox, it's mind-boggling why any person, nonetheless someone who's trying to woo women voters, would be so rude and disrespectful. And today, more reports of lawsuits alleging he wanted to have women fired because he found them not attractive enough to be hostesses.
Well, first of all, we'll get into that later, and there's a whole lot of information.
Allegations, but they're out there.
But CNN, the latest CNN poll shows him winning by 17% among married women. And the one area where bringing up these allegations from the 90s are very important is with millennial females. I've seen it firsthand on these college campuses. They care deeply about sexual assault. I've had women come up to me saying, I didn't realize that Ms. Clinton did this, hired private investigators to go after any woman who challenged her husband. And that's confirmed in a deposition. You can go read all about it.
That's not what Trump is saying, though. I think what you just got to, I think, is actually the issue that is happening within the Trump campaign to some extent, is that there are advisors who don't want him to talk about this at all. There are some advisors who do want him to talk about it, and then there are advisors who want him to talk about this in a different way. He is, in the way that you're talking about it. And that's not what he's doing at all. The way he's talking about it is a way that even some of his supporters say is not productive. So that's just, I think, a distinction.
Because he's talking about it, I believe, in the way that we've seen time and again, he actually thinks about women. That if we're not tens in his book,
The problem is that we're going from that, instead of talking about substantive issues, this has turned into a reality show. It has turned into one of those horrible daytime shows that you just want to cringe because you see people slugging it out with each other. And, you know, and I think that Trump has lost sight of the fact that the average American woman in America is a size 12. They look a lot more like me than they look like Melania Trump. And when he's calling people fat pig, when he's fat shaming people, he is fat shaming a majority of Americans. And it makes no sense for him to talk about the 400-pound hacker. And let me point out that I just think, you know, when you've got a Donald Trump or a Newt Gingrich fat shaming people in public, I don't know, man, but I think you got to have a minimum level of fitness yourself if you're going to have the gall to go out and fat shame anybody.
And I just want to add, Anderson, this issue of fat shaming that Anna raises, it's a very serious issue. I know some people will laugh it off, but the issues of eating disorders and, you know, I've talked about my own struggles in that area in the past, they're not a joke. I mean, we have an enormous problem in this country with young people with anorexia and bulimia, and that Donald Trump thinks he can just throw that out there, that people are fat, overweight, not pretty enough to have certain jobs. That's the kind of thing that eats away at young people, boys and girls, souls, and is really hurtful. And people listen. Children take in what presidential nominees and people in power say, and he's reckless. And that recklessness can be harmful.
Regardless of whether you think he should bring up Bill Clinton's scandals of the past, I mean, it is incredible that at this stage of a presidential race, that a candidate for a major party is talking about women's weight. I mean, after a while, it all seems so normal that this is what we're talking about. But at a certain point, like, you just step back and you say, wait a minute, we're 6 weeks away from somebody becoming president, and a legitimate candidate is discussing this.
But in large part because Hillary Clinton put this out there. It was not true. I wish there was a fact checker at the debate. It was unsubstantiated allegations that he used those terms for the former Miss Universe, first of all. I agree with you. He should not have mentioned the weight on Fox and Friends. It gave the story legs. That's why we're still talking about it tonight. But he never called her fat. That's been something that's been widely said that was not true.
Well, we don't know if it's true or not.
I mean, He called her an eating machine.
This was all documented at the time. This was all on TV. I can tell you that for the Hispanic community, is very familiar with Alicia Machado. She was, you know, and we remember when this happened. We remember when she was made to work out in public, like if she was a guinea pig, you know, working out in public. We remember her calling her an eating machine.
He fought
and her.
So this is not allegations. This was widely covered at the time.
But Kelly, whether he did or
not,
he fought for her to retain her title. The Miss Universe board wanted to take it away. I assume something in her contract said you have to maintain your appearance. Many media contracts have provisions like that. He fought for her to retain her title, and right, they wanted to celebrate working out in physical fitness, and they did it this way.
That was not a celebration of working out in physical fitness. If it was, he would have worn some sweatsuits and worked out with her.